Hey guys, how's it going? This is the first time I'm saying that, knowing that there are actually people listening. So it's good to get the feedback we've had, and it's great to know that people are listening to the episodes and getting something out of them. There are many more to come. I've been recording a few recently. This one is with Mark, who is a friend of mine who became a friend in Nepal, who has done over the years some amazing work with his NGO, 10 Friends. He is a master at listening, at taking a long-term view, and taking a low-key approach. So if there's anything you guys feel like doing to help him, please do, because their work is truly valuable in the long term. They're forming teachers and sending them back out to their own villages where they can really make change happen in a big way. Replicable change, which is just really exciting. But before we start, a few little housekeeping things. It looks like there's a group of people, group of listeners, sort of growing around this podcast. So that's cool. That's what the idea is to build a community of people that are interested in this stuff. So if you guys know of anyone who has a project which is cross-cutting, so by that I mean, you know, involving health, environment, women's stuff, education, or a combination of all of those, then let me know. There's one on the radar now for next summer, not this summer, so summer 2019 in India. More news on that as it happens. We're just working on permits, which is likely to take some time. If not, you can also help us by leaving a quick review on iTunes. Just a few words really helps people find us, so it'd be much appreciated. You can sign up on Patreon. You can click on some links where we mention books if you're interested in the books, or donate directly. Spread the word. Speak about this podcast or write about it on your own social media and blogs and podcasts. Or join us on a project next time there is one. I hope to announce one soon. And finally, we're in the process of designing some t-shirts, so more news about that later. But in the meantime, please enjoy this conversation with Mark, and do let me know what you think, and do let me know if you want anyone else on the show. I will try and get them. We're ready to reach out to people anywhere and everywhere. But in the meantime, I'm happy to present Mark's work, and I hope you enjoy the conversation as much as I did. So Mark, thanks for coming on. It's great to hear you.
Oh, good to be here. Thank you for the opportunity, Patrick.
Yeah, it's been a little while since we met, but we're in middle of February now. So, when did you leave Nepal? When did you come back?
I came back, I want to say December the 15th, right in there. I wanted to make it back for Christmas time here with my small family, and I did.
And take me through what had happened to the house by the time you came back. I saw that Sunita had posted recently that she was moving in. So what's been up? What that you know that I don't know? Maybe fill me in.
Sure. Yeah. And as I conveyed to you there at the time, when all the people left that were volunteers and working, and including myself, you know, the Earthship wasn't entirely complete, but that was a great opportunity, I think, that they really liked to finish the interior in their culture and their style and their way. And, you know, Sunita could put whatever color of paint she wanted in her bedroom and hang the photos on the wall the way she wanted, and without having the influence of so many other people. So actually, I think they really enjoyed those finishing touches and being able to do those by themselves, just to make it as they wanted it. But so since I left, they have built a kitchen room, which is just maybe 15 feet from the actual Earthship itself. It's very common in Nepal for there to be a separate kitchen space. With the kitchen inside the Earthship, it was just going to be a little tight in there to have a kitchen and Sunita's office and the girls' rooms and maybe a guest quarters as well. So it's a lovely little structure. I need to send you some photos of that. But it's more of a traditional Nepali style house. It's just a charming little white building with a blue roof and very, very well made. They'll use that, excuse me, for kitchen and also for storage for vegetables, for their potatoes. They store for long periods of time in a cool, dry place. So it'd be a very functional, useful building. Yeah, and that's pretty much it. They're pretty well entirely moved in now into that space and living happily ever after. They do need a couple other things, they said, that Sunita is requesting. They do need a wall on the downside of the Earthship where that monstrous pile of dirt was that you recall.
Yeah.
Which is just going to turn into a, you know, a muddy, landslide-prone disaster when the rains begin. So they'll really need to do something about that. And so she's looking for a little more money and some time from some workers there to complete that before, let's say, June or July when the rains start. So no emergency on that. But that's kind of the last thing, is to build that retaining wall around that bottom portion, and then they'll be good to go.
So they've got two rooms for the girls and then her office. And then they've got a little mini sort of, well, they've got the shower room and the toilet. So what's the third room going to be? Sunita's office and a sort of welcoming area, maybe a guest area.
Yeah. And Sunita's sleeping quarters too. I think it'll be all of those things that you mentioned combined, and including a place for her to sleep. Right. Office, guests, any guests can stay in there, and Sunita as well, just to give her a little time away from the girls. It's separate, with a separate wall between her and the girls' room. So yeah,
I can imagine she could need that. I mean, they are lovely girls, and I miss them. They added such a good feel, a good feeling to the project. I mean, they were the reason for the project, obviously, but their presence was incredible, wasn't it? In terms of how enthusiastic and helpful and hardworking and accommodating they were.
Yeah, that's what brings me to Nepal, you know, and keeps me going and you know, keeps the fundraising going here. Just the culture and the people and just how lovely they are. And, you know, maybe I want to say Nepalis are a little less emotional, but boy, I've never seen so much crying as when all the volunteers left. It was really a sad, sad time. They really grew attached to all of us. I know that was a very, very special experience in their life to have all those guests and people there serving and helping them and concerned about their future and doing what they could to help them out. So it was really, really neat. Yeah, but you're right. They did add a lot to it. And just their smiles and their ambiance and their personalities are quite amazing. Yeah.
Yeah, there was so much respect, wasn't there? Mutual respect from the volunteers towards them, from them towards volunteers. And they also were so... thankful, but everyone, it was just everyone was pulling in the same direction, and it was a really, really nice feel. I'd like to sort of let people know about the project in a sort of little brief history, because the thing that struck me about the HEC and the girls and Sunita was that there's a real sense of something very solid building up and of them being part of this process of training girls and then having it scale, hopefully, even though slowly. But that seems to be a key ingredient, and I guess that's a lot of questions in one, but my main question is, how did that culture of care and longevity, or, you know, long-term vision, how did that start?
Yeah, I think those kinds of large affect, like you're maybe describing, where it's not only a physical thing and a building and a program and a structure, but feelings too from the stakeholders, namely the girls and Sunita there, just about how important it is and what it's going to do and the outcomes it'll have for their culture and that region. It just takes a long, long time. I think that can't be built overnight. You know, it's taken years and years and years. And I became involved 10, 12 years ago through a man that I met, Josh Brody, who had started or initiated the Himalayan Education Center And he lived in Nepal for quite some time. He's an American, but was there just on a gap year or something out of college, I believe, and decided to stay much longer because he was there 4 or 5 years and learned Nepali fluently. And it was just he's a wonderful person. And he was in that region and somehow had discovered this lack of this whole vision, which now I've adopted and 10 friends has adopted, this long-term vision of just this lack of female educators and the discouragement that females get or lack of encouragement for education, you know, not only in Nepal, but so many other places. And he, with a Nepali friend of his, started the funding. I'm not sure how they got that initially, but got some funding to rent a small building, which we call a hostel. Now it's the Earthship where the girls live. But and Josh went with this Nepali friend of his, who I think had some background in social work. And they trekked up into the mountains and in the region near the Himalayan Education Center in Sankosoba district there. And selected the first several girls back, 14 years ago, something like that. And
what were the criteria of selection?
Well, yeah, at that point, as you know, there are many castes in Nepal, beautiful cultural aspects and histories to each of these castes, different language and dialects of the language that they speak throughout their castes. But you know, a caste system has its low castes and high castes. And so the Bhotia caste, or Bhotia, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, is one of the lower castes. And Josh was especially keen to bring girls up out of that caste. That caste is a mountainous caste that lives in the Himalayan foothills or even higher regions near Tibet, originally, apparently. Don't quote me on this, but I think most of them have come out of Tibet, or at least their ancestors did, I believe. Anyhow, Bhotia is a low caste, so Josh was especially interested in, you know, promoting that lower caste of girls who were especially discouraged or lacked the encouragement for higher education and the means to become educated, with the lack of educational resources in those little tiny Himalayan villages and the lack of encouragement. There's plenty of opportunity there. So those were really the criteria. First, smart, brightest. He'd communicate and network with the principals in those small little schools to find the brightest, talented, most driven girls. And pretty much at that time, like I said, it was they needed to be from the Bhotia caste. Now so those were the basic criteria. It's branched out now, and there are girls now from several different castes there, including Sunita, who's a Groong, which is a different caste. And I think there are a couple of Rai girls, and Rai is another caste as well. So, yeah, that's the basic history.
Yeah, they're the girls are, what, between the ages of sort of 12, is it, the youngest one maybe, and 18, 20 now, I think, the older one. No, am I getting that wrong?
No, I think you're about exactly right. I think Asmita, I want to say, is 20, and Chippa, yeah, I believe the youngest one is still 12. That's correct, yeah. So quite a range of ages there for sure, yes.
Wow. Yeah. It's great to think of them and think of their lives. I mean, I noticed one thing, I gave an English lesson at one point before everyone else arrived. I said, do you guys want to look at some phonetics or something? And they were so keen. And, I was used to having taught, you know, at some schools here in Italy where sometimes, you know, schools being schools, sometimes the kids aren't, you know, so super excited about lessons. But these girls were just really focused and absorbing every aspect that I was, you know, they're just so hungry for knowledge and for English, and not just English, for anything. They're just curious. And I think that's something that really got transmitted as well to us as foreigners. Yeah, that's such pleasant memories of working with them. At the moment, you know, people say, "What do you do? what is your answer to that at the moment? I mean, is
right, and that's a great question. So I think I guess I feel like I work in just all aspects of our nonprofit, and from, you know, all the stakeholders, from the fundraisers, volunteers to donors, I should say, and planning and preparing fundraising events, nurturing those donors, you know, properly thanking donors and making sure they're aware of progress and outcomes for the girls and for orphanage work that we do and other projects. But so communication with donors, telling a compelling story, you know, the story of the HEC especially is, it's just a little more multifaceted and complex because there's so many little parts and pieces to it, you know, and so telling that story in order to generate funds for it is maybe a little more challenging than some nonprofits, maybe not, but it's just, again, so many parts and pieces that, so I do that with videos. I make videos. They're not of super high quality because I'm not a professional videographer, but they do the trick. Used to pay a couple thousand dollars to a gentleman to make our videos for us, but started making them myself, conveying that story with videos, with speeches, speaking engagements, lots of presentations I do, and budgeting, and you know, all that stuff on this end of the equation, and then all the way on through to, you know, traveling to Nepal and working with distributing that money and making sure that it's spent properly and budgeted correctly on the Nepali end of things, and make sure donor money's not getting wasted or misappropriated. So lots of communication, I think, goes on in that side as well. Yeah, go ahead. Were you going to say something?
No, I was going to say, I mean, one thing I really felt like I learned, or if not learned, but definitely saw in what you do, is you listen, or it seems like you're listening to all of the various aspects of the project, from the kids to, you know, Sunita and the local politicians and participants, and then obviously with the airship build to all of the people on our side of things. And you mentioned complexity. What are some of the things that come to mind of subtle problems that maybe go unnoticed or unspoken about a lot of the time? Do you have any examples of those at all? Or?
Yeah, well, first, let me go back to your kind of first part there about listening. I really feel that's probably the most important part of what I do, is listening to Sunita or to whoever I'm working with over there, just to make sure that I am not imposing anything on them. I mean, I have some parameters about and some, you know, I guess some guidelines as far as how our money is spent there. And just to make sure I have that buy-in from the local people. So yeah, a lot of what I do is listening and making sure that what we do is appropriate to their culture, you know, and that we're not saying this is what we want to do based on our culture, but what do you want to do based on your culture, and how can our skill set and our money from our side help you to get to that space? So yeah, that's really huge. That's always been our kind of mantra since we began, is what can we do for you that you feel you need in your culture to give you those tools to rise up, to get a better education, to have, you know, a healthier life, to empower girls, what's best from your side. So, yep, listening is super important.
Listening is collecting information about what's going on there, what the social context is and their needs are. But at the same time, you're often arriving for a certain amount of time and there's knowledge to gather. How do you set about having the conversation about what's needed, or how do you approach the prioritization of possibilities with them?
Well, I meet with Sunita a lot when I'm there. You know, she's through time. Again, all these things take time. I feel like I've gained her trust and she has my trust. So we start with that, you know, mutual trust when we sit and we talk together. What she requests is in terms of things that she needs to help the girls better, to grow the program, to make improvements. You know, I generally am gonna, it's generally very compelling things. You know, they need, you know, a refrigerator, or they need solar panels we got one time for them. It's she's just very good at, you know, proposals that are that make sense for her. So really, I'm almost want to say I'm more of a follower of her, and she's asking as many questions of me as I am of her. So, you know, I guess I never really thought of it that way until I'm having to think of it deeply right now. But, you know, I follow her, and she questions me as much as I question her. Her proposals are always, you know, spot on, and things that are needed and not fluff. And, you know, she's a penny pincher, so she's really cautious with money. So I guess all of that you're asking about has just taken time for, you know, to develop that relationship with her or anybody that I work with over there. And that level of trust and questions that go both directions. And I guess a lot of the time I ask from her, you know, what's the outcome of that going to be? Whatever that request she may have or proposal, and how am I going to sell that to my folks back home that are going to give the money, and let's make it into that compelling story and weave it into the whole story here in the HEC. Because that's what I kind of have to do too, is take that story, that request, that need that she has for the girls, for their future, and bring it back here and, well, sell it, you know, make sure it's part of the process, that it makes sense, and it's going to grow or improve the program. So it goes both ways. I think our communication is based on trust, took time, and we both ask each other a lot of questions. So
that's what listening is, obviously. It's having a conversation. And that's the impression that I had from outside, was that it is exactly, as you said, a conversation where she formulates stuff. I want to dive in on one other thing here. You said that you tell the stories of the projects and you communicate that back home. And that's something that I'm beginning to learn to do. So I have a few questions about that. What do you think the non-tangible or the aspects of the Earthship that maybe you can't measure? You know, I mean, you can obviously see, you know, the warmth, you can measure the watts that are generated, you can see that it provides water. But there's another aspect of inspiration on one side, notoriety and fame and outreach, if you like, on the other side. What do you think the Earthship gives on a sort of secondary level, like not the primary aspects, but a secondary level in terms of story? And how do you think it furthers the project on a more subtle level, if anything? Maybe you don't have anything that comes to mind, but it's something I'm grappling with at the moment, because I feel this stuff, and yet right, I can't quantify it, because it's exactly that. It's a softer sort of gift.
Absolutely right. And that question comes up for us a lot, is how can we measure our outcomes and our success? And so for hard facts or hard information, I guess I want to call it measurable things that we can see, obviously the number of girls that come out of the program successfully, get their teacher credentials, and then succeed in finding a teaching job. We are able to see and measure that. And that's good. We have results. We have 13 girls that have graduated and are teaching. And I'm counting on Asmita to be next. She's the oldest girl, and she is solid. And I don't doubt that she's been there years. So I have no doubt that she is going to be successful in completing the program and becoming a teacher. So she'll be number 14. But we can measure those things. You're right. There are so many intangible parts and unmeasurable. If we have girls in the program and they do not, you know, complete their education, if they're needed back in their village for farm work and their parents pull them back out, is that a loss for us? And we don't think so. They've gained vital years of education that they will be able to use in so many parts of their life. We can't measure that, right? Again, like you said, if someone doesn't complete the program, then we don't get to check our box with another girl that's completed and become a teacher. But I don't feel like we lose from educating girls, even if they don't meet that end goal, in a place where it's just so hard for girls to get that education. Does that kind of...
It does. Let me explore the idea of the Earthship in itself, because there was something When I arrived there and I saw under Sunita's desk was the plan of the building, I felt like she'd sort of manifested this thing just as much as I had been doing, maybe on a shorter time scale, and that Seppi had been doing, that maybe you had been doing. And it was, she was really willing this thing to happen. And I feel like she wasn't just into it because she wanted a house. There was something more. And that's what I'm trying to ask about, that what can a building like that and a process like it has been give to the girls and to the project? That those are the intangibles I'm curious to see if you have any thoughts on.
Yeah, sure, I do. And like I said in that short video that I made, it is that visible statement now that it is not going to go. It's a permanent house and a really cool one, I might add, with so many amazing features and sustainable features in it that's of course a curiosity for that region and will be for all of Nepal. But the symbolism there, I think, is important, and the security that the girls will feel from not having to rent a place and that's permanent. They can put their sign, Himalayan Education Center, on that building, and it will be there for years and years and years and years. So, right, that permanence, I think, is very, very important, that they're not going to be moved off by a landlord or something. And obviously, it gives them a little bit more comfort in that they don't have to pay rent. We generate the money to pay rent pretty much through 10 friends. But, you know, something could happen to that or to me or to our funding sources. So, yeah, I'm sure that's a source of some concern when somebody else on the other side of the planet is responsible for sending you the rent to pay, you know. So there's that. Both of those are more affect and feeling things, you know, the visible statement of the earthship and its permanence and not having to worry so much about day-to-day operations and the rent payments as well.
It's put them on the map, though, as well. Do you remember that day when the local authorities came down, which was actually a make-or-break day, as far as I could understand it, in terms of permits, with majority world permits being a little bit less rigid than they are here in developed or whatever, misdeveloped countries, whatever we want to call them. There was this attention and respect coming from the politicians towards the project, though, and Sunita certainly felt the importance of that meeting. Do you remember it?
Oh, I remember it very well, and I remember that meeting or arranging it at the time. When I sat down in front of all those people, I realized how vitally important that was, that Sunita took the initiative to make that meeting, not only to make sure it was, you know, okay with the local authorities and the mayor and all that you know, by code, but or whatever codes there, but yeah, just to and your profound statements there about, you know, this is not an experiment. With thousands of earthships have been built around the world, but boy, yeah, when I sat at that meeting, I thought, wow, Sunita, good move, because I didn't even think of that. You know, Nepal's so loose, you know, with, like you said, with codes and maybe, you know, building requirements, that I didn't think of it, but it was critically important just to put their minds at ease, those local authorities, and make sure that they were on board with it. And that was great meeting.
Yeah, she that's part of her awareness, but I guess it was also that they definitely must have seen her and the organization as being, you know, having taken a step up. I mean, it's always a statement of intent to be able to pull off something like that, you know, first as a whole, and then there's something there that does all this stuff. And they took a step forwards.
Yeah. And you could see, like you said, you could see how the respect was mutual, you know, towards Sunita as well. She is starting to be a very respected leader in that area. And the Himalayan Education Center is something pretty much a lot of the local people know and are aware of now, and even more now, so after the earthship building. But they respect her too. She was a very respected part of that meeting, which is important. She is our Just a model, you know, of what we want out of the Himalayan Education Center, you know, for girls. She is that empowered leader that even the mayor and everybody listens intently to, because, you know, she has that education and she's a game changer. She's an amazing girl. She is what we want. So
is there the chance of scaling what's going on or not?
I think there is. Yeah. I've been having that question more and more now, you know, from you and from other people. I think that as time goes on, it's more and more of an option. There's that time, you know, from kind of the inception of a program to where you figure out if it's gonna work. Everything's an experiment, to whether it's gonna have the proper funding to, and whether from our side we'll be able to, you know, make that compelling story that keeps that funding going. And the track record is becoming, you know, longer and solid, and the funding has been there and the support, and we're getting the outcomes from, you know, as far as the girls that are graduating and becoming teachers. So that makes it less of an experiment, right? It's more of, well, this works. So, you know, that part being kind of behind us in the rearview mirror now, we can start to look at, gosh, how can we grow this? And can this be the first seed? And can we do this in other places? I think, you know, the only thing that's stopping it right now is the next level from 10 friends or from our funding, because that's a whole nother level of funding and support. And for me, it's just a part-time job. I always call it a hobby that I really feel fortunate enough to be able to do, but it would be a lot more work raising that money and communication and collaboration to begin planting other seeds, I want to say, like the HEC in Nepal or even in other countries. So that step comes from our end, but that might be the only constraint right now, is how to do it. You know, with our small volunteer base, would we have to hire somebody, that works more full time towards moving that forward? Like you said, I think that Sunita would be a perfect person to. I haven't talked to her about this at all. Right. But train and replicate, pretty much, because we have the model and it works, and we have the funding and people are interested and compelled by that story and that long-term vision here and that support and empowerment for girls. And even if it's on the other side of the planet from here, which is adds a level of difficulty in raising money. Some people feel that's a little diluted and they want to see change right in their backyard, you know, tomorrow in a quick way instead of somewhere so far away in a long-term thing. Other people, many are also sold on that long-term, and we have people that, you know, really want to give to something long-term that's not right in their backyard. So there are both camps of donors, but finding those people to continue support who are into that, seeding that out, having Sunita or somebody that knows that model on that end over in Nepal to train, another leader to rent a building in a region nearby or in another district of Nepal and go from there. You know, when these girls graduate and they become teachers and they affect, like you said, so many hundreds or thousands of children as a positive role model in their villages, that is really difficult to measure. It's an amazing, amazing, amazing outcome. And it happens, you know, for sure. But again, one of those immeasurable, intangible, but wonderful and amazing outcomes that we have from this program.
Cool. So 10 friends, are those 10 friends that you're still all together doing this, or is it evolving and people are having kids and doing stuff? And
I think it was a catchy name at the time, and it was 10 of us that went to Nepal on that kind of inspirational trip. Mostly it was my friend Rand and I, who is a teacher, I think I mentioned, and I who really kind of moved the 10 friends forward from there on. The friends are still friends, but they're not much involved in the 10 friends nonprofit at this point. Some of them are donors and still very interested, and participate from time to time, but 10 Friends was a name that just stuck at the time. So really, it's me and my friend Rand and another lady named Sally who do most of the, you know, fundraising and communication and collaboration and work on the Nepali side and run our board and that kind of thing.
It's difficult to do those more humble in the background activities that, you know, don't cover the organization in glory, but they do ensure that the, you know, the people who are being helped, if you like, get walking on their own two feet and can hopefully help others to do the same.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah, there was definitely no plan from the, no real specific plan other than deliver stretchers from the start, but it did mushroom and grow. And it's not about me, but I honestly say it's really been an amazing and rewarding and fulfilling part of my life that I did not expect it to be, because again, it wasn't about me, but it's certainly been very, very fulfilling for me as well.
How do you see it in 10 years' time? Did you ever think about that, or do you just take one day at a time?
Well, I'm all in now. You know, I got used to the grind and the parts I don't like, and I get enough, you know, intrinsic reward from it that at certain times, I want to say, but and just the commitments that I have now to people that I absolutely will not let down over there in Nepal, that I'll be in as much as I can until I can't walk or talk or Skype or do the work I need to do to make sure those programs that we do over there are secure. So 10 years from now, right, either sustaining as is and cranking out some teachers and making sure our orphanage is, you know, great and sending kids through that system in the orphanage, you know, and or a level of growth. That's the question, right? For the next year or two, is it scalable? And what can I do to bring that to that next level? Do I want to bring that to that next level? If I have a real job as a teacher, it becomes a little more challenging to accomplish, you know, big changes in Nepal and growing and scaling that HEC. You might be, I just don't want to resent it in the work, you know, I need to like it. So it can't go beyond a level that, you know, to a level that interferes with my personal life or my sanity. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do know what you mean.
It's very, very important that I keep it balanced so that we can continue doing what we do very well without stretching me or anybody else out too far. And
no, that resonates with what you were saying before and the way that it feels from the outside, that it is a slow, constant thing and not a sort of flash in the pan. But looking back over the last 10 years or 15 years, what have been your main lessons, or what sort of advice would you pass on if you met either yourself 15 years ago or someone else who's about to sort of embark on a similar adventure?
Yeah, I would say that I think the inequalities that there are, be that lack of encouragement for women, lack of medical attention in regions around, lack of water, vaccines, all those inequalities have taken decades, if not centuries, to be created, to come about. And so I think that the only way to reset that and to slowly dig out is going to be long term as well. It took a long time to get here, and it'll take a long time to bring those inequalities back to a level playing field all across the planet. So I would just emphasize long term,
yeah.
You know,
yeah,
the long term vision, which is not as sexy and rewarding immediately with something that happens locally, maybe in your backyard, or something that happens overnight, but is the only way. There's so much power in women, I would say, too, to bring them into the workforce. You know, that's just the huge untapped resource, I want to say, is women, right? They're excellent leaders. They're smart. They can work hard. Their leadership style is different than men, and I would argue a lot better leadership style.
Right.
You know, we need more women leaders for sure. But to bring them into the workforce in third world economies and out of the shed, you know, just taking care of the animals all day or working in the fields and into that decision-making process and empower them in their communities is the biggest and most powerful change force that there is. And it's going to take a long time. That won't happen overnight. So I would just emphasize, yeah, to people that bringing women up and be ready to wait for the results.
Wow. That really resonates with me, what you're saying. Totally. What resources are there to help people do this? I mean, I was sort of asking you about advice. That's definitely the approach is women, but what techniques, what routes are there to making that happen? From what you've seen, are there any corners you could have cut with the experience you have now compared to years ago? Or what would you tell someone else starting out and who is, you know, convinced like you are now? How would you help that person starting out?
I think that you have to search for those opportunities to be a change force. They don't just usually don't just walk in your door. You have to look, I think, for that niche actively to find a spot where you feel like you can make a positive change. So I think sometimes people wait to see what comes along for something that they feel impassioned about. And I think, you know, like I said, we have to be active and engaged in looking for that space in the world where you can make that difference in a niche, I guess. Again, in our case, you know, the HEC kind of came along and was dropped on our laps by Josh, who said, well, you know, I can't fund this anymore. Do you want to take it over? And it has been the perfect niche for us. So I would just say actively looking and searching. You can obviously help with your time, with your resources. If you don't have money to donate, you can, you know, donating money is great too. I mean, that's why there are nonprofits out there. Because that way, you know, people can work their normal jobs who are overwhelmed with their family or whatnot and can donate to somebody who can target a specific area or project or that they feel particularly passionate about. Or you can become actively engaged yourself. Anybody can start a nonprofit. And that's one thing that I have been really – another kind of side product, I guess, of 10 Friends that I was quite surprised about. I was, you know, again, there was not much of a path, especially at the beginning, but I was really amazed at how fulfilling it's been in my life. But I've also came as a surprise how many kids and children who are very enthused and passionate about and inspired by what I do. I do a lot of presentations at schools and for Rotary and that I didn't really expect, you know, as an outcome is to have that leverage on kids. 'Cause that's where I'm going to get a lot of traction that I didn't even realize, you know, years, maybe after I'm past my lifetime with these children that I can speak to and motivate to save some time in their life to help other people. No matter what that is, you know, beyond their family who comes first and their own needs, they will have time left over in their life to serve and help others and to try to make sure that they are aware of that and that they can be helpers too and change positive changes in force in the world. And so anyhow, kids are also very effective at raising money. You know, they once they get fired up about something, they go really, really big.
They go all in. They have that enthusiasm that is just second to none, isn't it?
Yeah. So I guess, yeah, they do. I guess in response to your question, actively searching for that role, keeping your eyes open for something that you're passionate about, if that's donating money to a specific cause or starting a nonprofit or not starting a nonprofit, just, you know, traveling to a different country where you can give back in your own special way with your time, maybe not with money. And the other important thing I think about nonprofit work is your duration, right? I think it is a flash in the pan for some people. And obviously the longer that we can stay engaged in anything, the greater the outcomes are going to be. So, you know, volunteer times that are short are going to be helpful, but the longer, the better. Months is great. Years are even better. Stick with it, I would say, is stick with it. Yeah.
Well, Mark, it's been great to hear this explicitly said, because it's something I'd always felt with what you've done and seen on the field, but to hear it explicitly makes a lot of sense. Two last questions. Any resources or books or websites or videos or films that you'd recommend to people?
Well, sure. I'm a big fan of Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. I would like to work for them. They're amazing people, giving back and in so many ways. And of course, they're both, Bill and Melinda are incredibly smart. They take a surgical, tactical, very well-researched approach to how they distribute their money, with lots of follow-up and data. Excellent reading about what they're doing on the Bill and Melinda Gates website. Really, really like those two. I like Little Princess. Oh, that's right. You can't see my face here. I have a book here, Little Princes, which is one man's promise to bring home the lost children of Nepal. That's a book by Connor Grennan. That's a good one. I like Second Sons. This is a book as well. It's about two doctors and their amazing quest to restore sight and save lives. And a lot of that is work in Nepal by some doctors. Yeah, I think that's all I can come up with on the top of my head there.
Sounds perfect. So where can people get in touch if they want to get in touch with you on the internet, email or social media or website or, yeah, whatever?
Sure, yeah. The 10 Friends website is 10friends.org, spelled out TENFRIENDS.org. And you can contact me there through that website or directly. My email is mark@10friends.org. We have a Facebook page as well. It's searchable, I believe. It's going to be a 10 Friends project. If you search Facebook, it should pop up rather than just 10 Friends. I think 10 Friends project will get you there. So, yeah.
Cool. Well, thank you. Thank you for being on and for having a great conversation about this stuff that we both get excited about.
Absolutely, it was my pleasure, and thank you for the questions. It, people don't often ask me questions of that depth, so it really, really had me thinking there. And I stumbled a couple times because I haven't thought that deeply about this stuff, at least recently. So it was awesome.
Well, that's great to hear, because it's something I feel like I'm new to, and like anything, you never realize. I think that's the part of the process of starting something, is realizing how you'd never realized how difficult it was, because most people you hear doing anything are the people that are good at it, and they make things look easy. So that's cool to hear as well. But listen, we'll be in touch, and thanks again, Mark.
Thank you very much, Patrick.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. Before you go, or rather immediately after you've gone, please go down to iTunes, leave a review, help us grow, get more guests, raise more money for projects. We have other projects coming up. You can find news about those on offgrid.vision, where you can also get access to other shows and some phenomenal t-shirts, which go towards, well, the profit of which goes towards new projects. If you have any requests for someone to come on the show, do let me know via the site. Until next time, thanks for listening, and see you soon.